Through it all,
it is well.
Kind of good. Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. I want to say a special welcome to those of you who are here, and we are looking forward to another time of worship together and a blessing from the Lord today as we've gathered here in His house. We got a full house today. The list is full, and I just wanted to go through a couple of things on that note about attendance. First of all, if you're planning to attend in person, you need to sign up online, and thank you for all of you who have done that. It's very helpful as we're planning, and it also helps us to comply with the rules that say that we can only have 50 people here in the sanctuary. So this is the second Sabbath in a row that our signups are completely full by Friday evening. So just a reminder, especially for second service, if you are planning to attend second service, you might want to log in early in the week and get your name on the list. Thank you so much for signing up. We don't want to have to turn anyone away, and so getting your name on that list helps us to not be in that position. When we're attending in person, just a reminder, we're agreeing to wear a mask properly. That includes covering our nose and our mouth at all times indoors, and then having no contact physical distancing at 6 feet at all times, indoors and out. So we're doing all of that because we love people, and we want to care for them and keep them as safe as possible. And also, in terms of taking care of people, we are not passing an offering plate during our services now. So there is an offering box in the foyer. You can feel free to use that. And we also encourage you to continue giving tithes and offerings online through our online giving. Just go to pvclife.com, and you'll see a link there for online giving. Our offering today is for youth support, and I believe that we have a video here that we're going to watch together. So let's take a look at the screen.
A year ago at this time, Adventist education was humming along. Schools were thriving, enrollment was growing, students were learning, and teachers were fulfilling their mission of Adventist education by reaching young people for Christ. We had no idea what was to come. When the pandemic hit the Oregon Conference, and schools had to close, it was a jolt for all of us. But it was amazing how quickly our schools adjusted to online learning. Our teachers were able to pivot in just one long weekend from in-person instruction to online instruction. Our staff, students, and families came together to make the best of a tough situation, and our schools continued to deliver on the promise of Adventist education. With the new school year, state requirements for each region differ, so school looks different at each location.
One thing that hasn't changed, the mission carries on. Here at Milo, the students get to enjoy the full-on in-person educational experience, with the appropriate precautions, of course.
Here at a Columbia Adventist Academy, things look a little different. CAA is allowed to have part-time in-person instruction with only a portion of the learning happening online. At Portland Adventist Academy, they're still waiting for the state to let them open in person. Yet teachers are creatively meeting the online-only challenge to provide a top-notch education for our kids. While schools look different, the mission continues. The Oregon Conference Youth Support Offering financially supports our conference senior academies as they adapt to the changing needs brought on by this pandemic. When you contribute to the OCYS offering, you invest in the mission of our Adventist academies. So far this year, with churches closed for months and the uncertainty in our society, support has dropped by half. Your generous support of this fund now will advance the mission of Adventist education and invest in the lives of young people across our conference. Oregon Conference Youth Support is not just another offering. It's personal.
As I look around this morning, first service and here in second service, I see teachers and I see students, and I'm thankful for all the ways that that teachers are ministering, even in the midst of lots and lots of changes. So teachers, know that our prayers are with you, and everywhere I see a parent, I see a teacher as well. So our prayers are with you parents as well. It's our 40 days of prayer continues, and this is our fourth week. I think today is day 29, is that right? And so thank you for continuing as we pray through the Psalms together, one in the morning, one in the evening, and just continue to lift each other up and continue to ask the Holy Spirit to be poured out here in our church family and to give us the discernment in these times to know how God is leading. And so let's continue to pray together. We have some membership changes, and because we don't have a printed bulletin, we're going to do those by reading and in on the screen. We have two people joining, and that is Juan Barone Campos from Vancouver and Gerard and Fran Seaton from Littleton Church in Colorado. And those we'll have a second reading next week, and we'll vote those membership changes next week. Just a reminder, at the end of the service, please remain seated, and the deacon will dismiss you after the service is concluded. Let's stand together and read our call to worship today. It's taken from Psalm chapter 9. Psalm chapter 9. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. When my enemies turn back, they stumble and perish before your presence. The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. And those who know your name put their trust in you. For you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Sing praises to the Lord who sits enthroned in Zion. Tell among the peoples his deeds. Let's stay standing and let's do what we just said. Let's sing together to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise with a mighty hand. Mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. By the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. For Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever.
I know this is a song that probably is super familiar to us, but it's not just a song we're singing. These words are like truth for our souls right now. By the grace of God, we'll carry on. Let's sing that chorus.
Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever.
God, we just thank you for your presence this morning. We thank you for the promise that you are with us, that you never leave us or forsake us, and that in everything that we face, you're Lord all over all of it. You can be seated.
Grand earthquake before, moved by the sound of his voice, and seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken from my regard. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me. Far be it from me to not believe. Well, is well with me.
Let's go to our knees, church.
Good morning, Father. Good morning, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's gray and cool outside, Lord, but the trees are shouting the bright colors of fall, and we sense your presence in our midst today. Amen. From this sanctuary, and the sanctuary of our homes, we bow our heads and lift our hearts to you in praise and gratitude. In the beginning, you created the heavens and the earth by your word, amazing beauty and incredibly diverse creatures showed up everywhere. You formed mankind from the earth and breathed life into us. The next day you set aside as a day to rest from your labor so you could spend time with your creation and we could get to know you better. You made that day holy, Lord, and that's why we are here, to get to know you better. Father, forgive us for how we've treated your creation, how we've treated each other, and how he treated you. Our continuing rebellion not only hurts us, but grieves your heart. We hear all creation groaning as we groan with it. Thank you, Lord, for not abandoning us. We praise you, Jesus, for loving us enough to re-enter our world, to live and to die for our sins, and to cleanse us, to give us new hearts and new minds through the gift of your indwelling spirit. Lord, we lift our broken lives, our friends, like Bonnie and John, up to you. We lift our family members and neighbors who are suffering today from illness, from painful relationships, from financial worries, from discouragement and despair. We lift up our national and local leaders. We lift up our pastoral team and their families. Lord, may our eyes be open today to see ourselves more clearly and to see your smiling eyes of love. Lord, may our ears be open to hear your words of hope and direction today. May our bodies feel the healing warmth and comfort of your strong but gentle touch. May our hearts be filled with gratitude, joy, and praise in the midst of today's darkness, because we have seen the light of the world in Jesus Christ, our lover and redeemer and friend. And Lord, may our minds be open to the Holy Spirit today in this service. May we understand more clearly your love for us. With all that you have done for us, Lord, we just bring ourselves to you right now, and we bring this prayer to you, and we know that you will hear and answer because of your promise to be with us and your promise to respond to prayers that are brought before you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And in his name we pray, amen. Amen.
If you are watching online, worshiping online today, we just want you to know that our prayers are with you there at home, and you are a part of this church service as well, and so just wanted to make sure that you knew that. Also, by the way, Mom, if you're watching, happy birthday. So we're going to sing a song today that's a new one for many of you, maybe the first time you've heard it. It's a beautiful song called He Will Hold Me Fast. And Pastor George asked us if we would sing this song, and it's not one that I had heard before. So we learned it, and I think it's going to be one that will be with us here at PVC. So I just want to invite you to learn it, and don't feel pressure to sing if you're not sure of the tune yet, but we're going to sing through the chorus a couple of times right now just so you can kind of get a feel for it, and it goes like this. He will hold me fast, He will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. We'll do that again. He will hold me fast, He will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. You guys sound good. You'll get the verse too. When I fear my faith will fall, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, He will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast, He will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Those He saves are His delight, Christ will hold me fast, precious in His holy sight. He will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises are last, not by Him at such a cost. He will hold. He will hold me fast, He will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. For my life He bled and died, Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied, He will hold me fast. Raised with Him to endless life, He will hold me fast. Till our faith is turned to sight, when He comes at last. My Savior loves me so, He will hold me fast, He will hold me fast, He will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so, He will hold me fast. All right, hang on to that one because we're going to sing it again at the end.
And all God's people said, oh man, it is so good to be home in church, amen, all week long, longing for this day, and longing to be together with the people of God. We're loved ones. We're loved ones, each other, in Jesus' name. He's made us family, and this is something beyond anything that anybody could program or make. No, this is a Holy Spirit thing that draws us together. And what a joy to be able to lift our voices in praise. Thank you so much, Pastor Greg and Pastor Emily, for just leading us in these songs that God is, you know, it is well. It's well with my soul in the midst of all of this. It's well. And I'm glad to see some little ones, younger ones. And I just want you to know, and I want you especially for you to know who are watching this on live stream, but I mean, you know, something special is going to be happening next Saturday night, which is, I think, next Sabbath is October 31. And we're going to do our Reformation celebration. We're going to invite boys and girls to dress up in Bible costume, or to dress up in maybe a hero of faith. And it's going to be kind of this drive-by kind of thing where you come and you'll get out, and we'll be here to kind of guess. There'll be some of us dressed up too, and we'll kind of guess who you are, and you guess who we are. And then we have a special thing to give you, a little bag. And it's just going to be a time where we just rejoice together. So our hearts and prayers are with our families and with the parents of little ones, especially in this challenging time. So good to be here. We're going to open God's Word. And open His Word and seek what He has to say to each of our hearts, each one of our hearts this day. Let's pray together. Lord God, thank You so much for the privilege of being able to come together. You've called us to come and to seek Your face, and we're here, Lord. We're seeking You. Thank You for being the one who drew us through Your Spirit. And thank You for this privilege to be together as the family of God, gathered together to hear the Word of God. So it's our prayer this day, Lord, that Your Holy Spirit will have freedom. Freedom in our minds, in our hearts, and that as we hear Your Word proclaimed, that we will say yes to You, our Lord and our God. In the name of Jesus, amen. So this past week, I saw a video that someone had posted on Facebook. And it was a video of a Greek intercoastal ferry ship that was coming across the water headed towards a small harbor somewhere there in the Aegean. All these little islands and people going here and there and everywhere. And here is this ferry coming this direction. And the sound was on as I was, and it was a kind of a sound. It was just this, the waves were big, and the wind was blowing, and you could see, and this ship was coming at speed. In fact, as I watched it, I actually felt myself becoming anxious, because I see the ship coming at speed, and this harbor's not big. I mean, this harbor was kind of smallish. It was a little harbor, and it was kind of a seawall, kind of a breakwater seawall kind of thing. And there was this slot that this ship had to hit. And apparently this wind was blowing with such force that this ship had to come at speed in order to be able to not be blown into the seawall as it came through that slot into the little harbor. And so as it came, I went, oh, how is this thing? Is this going to end well? And I'm watching, and this ferry ship comes in there, and it makes its way. It hits the slot just right, and in they go. And I thought, good job, Captain. Good job. And then it struck. I thought, oh, my. He is coming at such speed. Is he gonna go up on the docks? I mean, I don't think he's going to stop. And as he came, all at once, this captain, and I don't know how he did this, reversed one engine, but I don't know how he did it, but he did a 180 in this tiny little little rectangle of a harbor. And he comes in and does this 180 and heads over to the docks where they would cast the lines. But as he came, that wind just, and you could just see him. And all at once, as he's getting there, boom. And he heads back out toward that slot, goes through the slot. And as he got through that slot and hit those waves, I thought, he's going back out to sea. And first of all, I thought, what a captain to be able to come in and do what he just did. But secondly, I thought, those poor people. I hope that, their hopes were up. We're going to get to land. We're going to get to shore. We're going to get to a place of safety after to get off this raging sea. And off they go. And I'm thinking, I hope the cars are all strapped down and, all the stuff. And off they go. And I'm going, those poor people. And then suddenly it hit me. That's us. I don't know about you, but ever since back there on March 12 and when Governor Brown said we're going to have to shut down for a few weeks here, we've been on a voyage none of us ever signed up for. Are you with me on this? Is there anybody that did sign up for this one? He's like, yeah, I want to be on that cruise. Oh yeah, that's the one I want. No. Here they are. We're on this voyage we never signed up for, and we have been hoping all the way through this. We're going, okay, it's going to happen soon. We're going to go ahead and make land and, terra firma, get out and kiss the ground, and we're there, back to the harbor called back to normal, okay? Keep hoping for that one. I remember it was middle to the end of May, and I was having a conversation with my son, and actually it was both my son, Matt and John, and I said something like, well, I think probably in a couple weeks here, maybe. And my son, I think it was Matt, who said, he says, Dad, there's no way this is going to, he said, July 5. It's got to be July 5 because, get through the July 4 holiday weekend with all big gatherings. And then on July 5, kind of open up again. I think that might work. And I thought, wow, July 5 is like a long ways away. I remember thinking that. In fact, I don't know how I'm going to make it to July 5. So here we are. In a couple weeks, we're gonna be like 9 months in. On this voyage that none of us ever signed up for. And it's been exhausting. Anybody with me on this? There's something that you may have heard of, this new term. I heard someone say, COVID fatigue. Anybody heard COVID fatigue? Well, you're looking at him right here, okay? COVID fatigue is just like, how long? It's been exhausting. And I think of the frontline workers. I think of those men and women who are walking into hospitals every day, clinics. Thank you. Thank you for what you do. Thank you for going there. And we know. We don't think about it like you and your families do. We forget about it. We take it for granted. Well, that's your job. Huh? But you're going in there putting your lives on the line, and we just thank you. I think of parents with kids. We just had the joy of spending time with our daughter and four grandchildren and watched this whole thing going on and watched, a two-year-old trying to wear a mask, okay, and to go out and all this stuff. Exhausting. And we just want you to know our prayers are with you. And thank you, moms and dads, for your commitment to these children that God has entrusted you with, and that each home becomes a little. I was reading a guy this week. He said every home must become every. This is, we don't know when this is going to end. That's the part that hits us here. We don't know what the end is. And he said, every home must become its own little monastery. I thought, okay, that'll work in an Adventist congregation. We're all going to be our own monastery. Yes, but it's to be a worship center where families are leading their little ones to Jesus. And that we can be here as we can, even in limited numbers, to be that support for you families. With school, with church, all these pieces. Life hasn't stopped. Life hasn't stopped, and death hasn't taken a holiday in these months either. I sat down this morning, and And I got out my little day timer, and I keep in there, and I look at my list, and I counted that death has touched this congregation, members of this congregation, 24 times. 24 times since we began. Jeannie, our hearts are with you and our prayers are with you. To lose your dear Bob and then your son 3 weeks later. I mean, this is, you can't make this stuff up. The pain that people have experienced through this and the losses. So for us, this is real. Every one of us knows it. And none of us knows, you know, that end point. By the way, your pastors are not immune to what's happening. I want to share with you some statistics that have come from, I just heard this week, and thank you, Ed, for sending this to me, but it was a piece from Barna, the research group, and they made the statement, they said that Barna surveys churches across the denominations across the United States. And said that pastors are struggling. And so this is what we discovered, is that through this pandemic, that pastors are struggling, and they are struggling with what it takes to reopen and with all the compliance issues around reopening. That there's a real struggle. And in fact, pastors are reporting, and this is the quote they gave, it's never been harder. They've never had a harder time than the last 6 months. Ours is a generation that didn't go through World War II. We're on this side of that. But for this generation, that pastors are saying they've never had a harder 6 months in their lives. One of the things that they reported in this last, this was within the last 2 weeks, this poll, that at the beginning, back in March, Barna did a polling of pastors, and they found that fully 50% of pastors said, we believe that with this crisis of COVID coming on us, that people's spiritual walk with the Lord is going to go stronger. 50% of pastors said that. There's going to be a strengthening and a deepening of the walk with the Lord through this time. 1% said, I'm afraid it's going to get worse for people, that their spiritual walk will go south. 2 weeks ago, that was March. 2 weeks ago, the poll taken, and now it's 50 point something and 49. 50 point something are still saying, I think this is going to strengthen people spiritually. 49% point something are saying, I think it's destructive in people's spiritual lives. That's huge. 1% to 49% after watching what's happening. That's a heavy burden on the hearts of a pastor, on the heart of a pastor, on the pastor's hearts. That's huge. To think, what's happening? Is this going to actually tear us apart? Is it going to tear people away from their Lord, from Jesus? This next one may or may not surprise you, but it's a big. They discovered in this poll that the emotional well-being of pastors is flashing red. That 1 out of 5 pastors is reporting being depressed and really struggling. That's 20%. The normal here, that when they did their polling just in back in normal times, you know, BC before COVID, but back there, then back then they found 1% in this reporting this way, and now it's 1 out of 5. That's 20%. So pastors, we need your prayers. And thank you for the way you love us, and you do. I mean, we are as privileged as any pastors anywhere. We know we're loved. And we experience it, and there are ways that you call us, you tell us, you just help us know that we're not alone in this thing. And we want to be able to help you know that you're not alone, you and your family as well. One of the biggest concerns, well, first of all, on a plus side, pastors report being really, really thankful and just saying, hey, we're excited the way that this hybrid church kind of thing is working. We're excited about the way Zoom has connected in people that have never been able to connect before. And I know that's true, like on Wednesday nights with Wednesday Bible Fellowship. We've got people as far away as white salmon, you know, that are coming in and being part of. By the way, we're in Romans 9, and you're all welcome. This is exciting stuff. But we're in Romans 9, and we're in there, and we're together in the Word of God, and it's just, but that, so that side's good. We're happy with the way that this whole tech thing has really helped us to widen the circle. But the greatest concern on the hearts of pastors is for the next generation. Millennials, young leaders to be developed. It is so good to see millennials here this morning. So good to see you guys. But for millennials, and then for the children of the congregation who can no longer be involved in the Sabbath schools and the ways in which we help nurture faith. So this storm that we're in, are we alone in this thing? Do we ever feel alone? We feel a little, yeah, we feel it. But are we? No, we're not alone. Let's go to one of my favorite storm stories in the Bible. One of my favorite storm stories. It's in Matthew chapter 14 and in verse 22. Matthew 14 and 22. And it's a story that actually is amazingly relevant. It's amazingly relevant to the time in which we live. Because it starts off by saying, immediately he, that is Jesus, made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. What? What's going on here? Immediately, he made the disciples. What are you doing? Why is Jesus making the disciples? I mean, these guys are fishermen. They've you know, spent their lives on the sea. And it's time to go, and well, you just go get in the boat. But Jesus made them. And we go, huh? Well, we get a bigger picture of this in John chapter 6, because in 6, what he says is, it says that as, by the way, this is the day that Jesus fed the 5,000. He feeds the 5,000. Then, as he feeds them, the people are there in the wilderness, and they're eating this bread, and they're going, wow, this is amazing. 5 loaves, 2 fishes, and they're all sitting there looking at each other, and someone says, do you think he might be the prophet, capital P, that Moses said would come, Deuteronomy 18. Do you think he might be the prophet? This guy that is going to come and he's going to be like Moses and he'll actually feed in the wilderness? And then, isn't that amazing? You go, oh, it's a prophet. He's going to lead us to this deeper walk with God. And then someone says, let's make him king. Bingo. Fast forward to today. Has anybody heard we have an election coming? You see what's happening here? We want the world to work. And whether we're more on the left or more on the right, wherever this thing is, it's like if we can get the 51% of the vote, and then we get this, and then we get to make it in our image, and we're gonna fix it, we're gonna make the world work, and it's gonna be better this way, and this way, and you go into this, and here's Jesus looking at this thing, and they're going, let's make him king, because he'll deal with the Romans, and then the world will make the world better. We're gonna fix it. And of course, you know, you have to shed some blood to do that. I mean, you can't make an omelet without breaking some eggs. Are you with me here? Okay? And so, that's good. Yeah, well, that's collateral damage. And yeah, maybe there'll be some blood in the streets, but you know, it's going to be a better world. And Jesus is saying, oh, hey, guys, the kingdom of God is within you. You know, this, my kingdom, when I bring my kingdom, the kingdoms you're talking, is not what I'm talking about. Your kingdoms are all beasts. With me there, Daniel? These are the beasts. Revelation? Those are the kingdoms that watch out. God's people better watch out. And so does everybody else. There's a lot of bloodshed in that. But my kingdom, he says, that's the one. That's the one that's the rock that's going to build, you know, the foundation of a kingdom that's based on justice and on righteousness and on love and all the things that we want and we need and we want to see in human flourishing that can happen. So this passage is very relevant to the time in which we live. Jesus said, in fact, if you read this in Desire of Ages, it's interesting. Ellen White says that the disciples are there like, the disciples are excited. Did you hear them say it? They want to make him king. Yes. That's right here. This is the time. We're in the wilderness. The Romans aren't around. Let's set it up and let's march on Rome, or march on Jerusalem. Let's go. And they're all excited about Jesus, King Jesus. And Jesus walks over and he says, come here. And they come over and he goes, get in the boat. What? Get in the boat. Now, these are big, strong men. Get in the boat. I mean, everything in them said, no, no, we're not getting in the boat. And they get in the boat. They go, what is he doing? This was the moment. We could have done this thing. We could have made the world a better place. Come on, get in the boat. And they get in and they start off. He turns around and dismisses the crowd. He had to get rid of, had to have his disciples away first. He couldn't keep them, that group together. He had to separate them out. And then he goes to the crowd and says, you've had your fill to eat. Your little ones are full. Are they? Are they? We have extra here if you need anything. Okay, everybody good? Okay, go home. Go home. No. No king. And what does Jesus do? It says, verse 23, after he dismissed the crowd, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. Let's see. Way back at the beginning, after his baptism, he'd gone out in the wilderness where Satan tempted him. And what did he say? If you'll just bow the knee to me, don't even have to go down. Now, just genuflect. Just do a little, tip of the hat. I'll give you every kingdom on the earth. Jesus had already faced this thing, and he faced it again. But he goes back and he goes into prayer in order to not waver, in order to not in any way let the devil have a foothold on him. And he goes into prayer. And evening came and he was there alone. Alone in that place in prayer. This being alone in prayer, I got to tell you, through these 8 months, 8+ months now, but I bought one of these things, and I guess it was at Barnes & Noble, I don't know where it was. It was a bookstore, but I got this little thing. It's like the size of my page, a little bit smaller, and it has a little piece on the back for a battery. I think it's, is it double or triple A? I think it's probably triple. It's small batteries. Put them in there, and I can turn this on. It's just a little plexiglass kind of shield, and I put it over my Bible, and so in the middle of the night, I can turn this on and read. And so when I wake up in the morning, it's still dark, and I can hear Leanne beside me. She's still breathing, and that's good. Boom, and I turn that on, and I've been going, and I do my 40 days of prayer. This morning, ascribe to the Lord, glory to his name. And I start going to this, right in the dark, to be there in the darkness before all the distractions of the day, and my head starts doing all the stuff I got to do. And it just, oh man, I tell you, to pray in that alone place where you're not alone. Are you with me there? Not alone. But the boat by this time was a long way from land. John tells us they were 3 or 4 miles out at sea. And John tells us that they were rowing. You know why? Because the wind was in their face. It was against them. And they had this one sail rig going on. And it says the wind was in, and they were beaten by the waves. The wind was against them. This is a hard night. And it's a night where the storm is rising. And here they are. And they're fighting this thing, and they're out there. And then in the fourth watch of the night, anybody know what time the fourth watch of the night starts? Which one? 3 a.m. Anybody here acquainted with the hour 3 a.m.? Know it up close and personal? Sorry to say, my hand's up. I'm sorry to say, because I believe it's a faith thing. It happened to me last night. I'm looking forward to Sabbath, and our window was open last night, and it's just been wonderful having the window open with all the wonderful autumn air, and all at once I wake up with these coyotes, and there's something about that sound of those, and then I hear that sound, and I go, oh, I think I know what just happened, and I hear that sound, and it hits something deep and primal in me. And it just tips me right over into fears. Isn't that something? I'm pretty much of a big boy, But and there I am. And then it's like, boom, that, and then boom, 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 boom. There's this stuff is just waiting to just jump on there and pile on is what's happening. And there we are in that fourth watch, and it's dark. And these disciples are out there in the dark. They don't have flashlights. And they're on a boat, and they got waves. If they're against the wind, and they're fighting this thing, there's waves breaking over. At least 3 or 4 guys have to be bailing. I mean, this is serious stuff. There's something about this thing where we go into, okay, I go into, but it'll tip me right into, when my fears tip me right into fear of death. You go, what do you mean fear of death? Well, you know, has anybody in the last 8 months gotten a little sore throat that made you wonder? Okay, I was the only one. All right, good. Okay, so, we think about things. Well, but if this happens, and if there's this economic, like if it keeps going, and then there's be this collapse thing, and then okay, so then the check doesn't come, and then I can't buy my groceries, and then I'm going to die. I mean, this way that the enemy takes these fears in our lives. And so what's happening with the disciples? They're out there in the dark, 3 a.m., fighting for their lives. And what do they see? I love this. In the fourth watch of the night, look at the next words. In the fourth watch of the night, four words. He came to them. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that amazing? In the midst of this thing, he came to them. Jesus is coming again, coming again, coming again. Jesus is coming. He came to them. Does he come to us? Even now? Walking on the sea. Whoa. Walking on the sea? What in the world? We know Jesus is a good walker. He just walked 3 or 4 miles on the sea here. And there he is. Verse 26. And the disciples see him and say, ah, yes, it's Jesus. Is that what they say? They see him and they're terrified. And they go, it's a ghost. This is a great, great message for Halloween coming up. Okay, so it's a ghost. And they cry out in fear. It's a ghost. What are they saying? They see him. They're fighting for their lives. They see Jesus. And they say, oh no, here comes death. Is that confusion? Here comes the life giver, and they say, yikes, here comes death. In the midst of this thing, have we been seeing stuff? Is God in this thing? Is he in this, on this COVID sea? And have we been looking and calling it death? Someone said to me just this week, it'll never be the same again. And that's true. And that's a great loss. I had a thought this week. I thought, I sure wish Pastor Emily could have been with us when we were packed house and all lifting our voices in praise. And I wish you could have had that experience with us. See, there are these things that we've lost, that have gone, that we don't, we go, how do you get this stuff back? I remember our last Sabbath together with Pastor Jonathan. We were all here together. We had the soup supper, you know, and we had the Friday night and Saturday night, and all those gourmet soups that we did, and then we'd all come together in here and just lift our voices and sing about good gospel, and oh, man. There's so many things. And we're looking and we're going, okay, it's death. It's all gone. It'll never come back. Yet it's here's Jesus coming to them in the middle of the storm. He's coming in the midst of the storm, and they yell and they scream, ah, it's a ghost. I love his next words. When he heard them cry out, he immediately spoke to them and said, take heart. Take heart. It is I. Do not be afraid. This is the word of the Lord to you and me. Don't be afraid of what? Death. Don't be afraid of death and all of those proximate issues in our lives that we tip, 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 tip till death. Don't be afraid of death. Take heart. I love the word take heart because in the French, and someone here would know French better than me, but I think it's C-E-O-U-R. Is that how it's spelled? But it's the root word for courage. This take, you know, be courage. Take courage. I'm with you. I'm here. And I love Peter's response. Peter says, Lord, if it's you, command me to come to you on the water. Is there anybody else here who would have responded like that? Anybody here? Braden? I mean, come on. You know, it's just like, if that's you, Jesus, I thought you were a ghost a minute ago. Of course, if you're a ghost, you could be lying to me right now. So if it's really you, I mean, what is going on? Peter, tell me to come to you. Peter gets out of the boat. Now, in a storm, in a boat, the only thing that secures your life, stay in the boat. What are you doing? I mean, what are you going to do? You're going to get out of the boat? And you think about that boat. Keely, who lives at Pastor Greg's house, Keely's actually building a boat for her senior project. I got to see a picture of it. And this morning, she was in first service, and I asked her, I said, Keely, how thick is the hull on that? And I said, is it an inch thick? Oh, no. And Pastor Greg thinks it might be, what, maybe a quarter of an inch? That's what we call security that's going to keep us alive on this sea and in this storm. So when Jesus is out there, he says, I love it, because Peter says, tell me. And Jesus says, what's he say? Come. He's like, Peter, I've been waiting for you to ask this question for a long time. Yeah, come on out of the boat. Leave your security. Step out of the secure zone that you count, you've put your whole life on, you're protecting, but you step out of that thing and come to me. I've been waiting for this, Peter. Somebody here think their 401k is going to carry them through? Someone think that they're, you know the equity is going to be, yeah, that's going to hold it. Surely it won't dive, right? I mean, we're just going to, you know, all that stuff. And he says, yeah, Peter, leave the boat. Leave your security. And you step on this and you come to me. And Peter does. And this is where the miracle, not only for Peter, but for you and me, the miracle of being raised up as new creation people to walk in the Spirit, it's happening. We trust him with our lives. So what does he do? Come, Peter gets out of the boat. He walks on the water, and I love these words. He came to Jesus. He came to Jesus. It's about right there, the third from the bottom. Came to Jesus when he saw the wind. Now, so here he is. He's come. No, here he is. So, by the way, I love Peter's motivation. Peter's in the boat, but he wants to be with Jesus. You get this? His security matters less to him than being close to Jesus. Lord, if it's you, command me to come. Last thing you commanded me was to get into the boat. Get in the boat. I got in. Now if you command me to come out, I'll come out. Okay, I'm getting closer. I'm getting closer. Getting closer to Jesus. And then what does he do? He stops and looks at his circumstances. He looks around and goes, when he saw the wind, what are you talking about? You get out of the boat. You turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full into Peter and Jesus were eye to eye. Eye to eye. Peter's walking on the water. Why in the world? And the closer you get this close to Jesus, and then you stop and go, oh my goodness, there's wind. There's waves. Really? Boom, as soon as it happened, when they saw the wind, he was afraid, and then he began to sink. And he's going down for the last time, and he cries out, Lord, save me. I love the next two words. Do you know what they are? Jesus immediately. That's for you and me this morning. Jesus, when he gets around to it. Jesus, maybe sometime next week. Jesus, no. Here he is, and he goes, Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him. What's the last song? What did it say? He will hold me fast. Do you think the grip of Jesus on Peter was, kind of so-so? Wow, can you imagine? I mean, there's a grip. Do you think Peter was doing the fishy handshake? Like, hey, how's it going? No. I mean, is he holding back? He's going to hold on. But I'll tell you what, it's the reach of Jesus. He took out, he took a hold of him. He will hold me fast. He is not going to let me go. My life is in his hand. Amen? My life is in the hand of Christ. And Jesus takes hold of him and he looks at him and he says, "Oh, little faith. Oh, little faith. Why did you doubt? You got this close to me. And then, wow, little faith." And I think about Peter. We know the stories about Peter. And we know that even there at the Garden of Gethsemane, and then when he's at the trial, you know, and there he is, and he's cursing and swearing. I don't even know the man. I mean, all of this stuff in Peter's life. We know that Jesus told him there at the book of John, the last up there in Galilee, and he said to Peter, "Someday a day is coming." He says, "Peter, do you love me?" Isn't this beautiful? Three times he denied him. Three times Jesus says, "Peter, do you love me?" In front of the disciples, he allows him to re-enter into it with all of that, and Peter gets to say, "I love you, I love you, I love you." He says, "Feed my sheep, Peter, feed my sheep." And then he says, "Peter, there's a day coming where someone's going to bind you, and they're going to take you where you don't want to go." And Peter knew it. He knew that it meant he was going to be taken and his life would be taken. And he's learning as he went forward to trust Jesus. I love it in Acts chapter 12. On the night when Peter is bound between two soldiers, not bound, chained, chains on each wrist, to soldiers' wrists, and he's there, and the text says the next morning, he is facing death the next morning, and what is Peter doing in the middle of the night? Sleeping like a baby. That's the faith I want. Here's this little faith, Peter. Little faith. "Oh, you little faith, why did you doubt?" Here's little faith, but here comes Peter now, and we see Peter, and the next morning, he's going to go, and Herod is going to execute him for his faith in Jesus. He's going to take it, his life will be taken, and he's just sleeping. He's sleeping like a baby. And the angel couldn't just say, it actually says the angel had to strike him, had to like smack him a little bit. "Wake up, wake up, wake up. You know, come on, let's go." And there he goes. So this Peter of little faith becomes Peter of great faith. That's the invitation for you and me. That's the hope that we have as we look and go, "Okay, Lord, if I fall and walk like Peter, could this be my reality too?" If you have your Bible, turn to 1 Peter. We're going to end here with hearing Peter's. We're going to close with hearing Peter's testimony of great faith. And I love the words he uses here. You know, in 1 Peter, he's writing to people who are already facing the persecution of a guy named Nero, Caesar Nero. Caesar Nero, who's already rounding up Christians and taking them to the Colosseum to meet their end as they meet lions in that place. And here's Peter writing to encourage people. And listen to his words. This great faith, this man of little faith who now expresses great faith. Verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great mercy." Great mercy. God protecting me from what I do deserve. Remember, what is grace? God giving me what I don't deserve. Mercy, God protecting me from what I do deserve. God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great mercy, has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Is this good or what? Remember he said before, what he's saying to us and to you and me? Don't fear death. Don't fear death. He's saying, I have defeated death. I am victor over the forces of darkness. So we're born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead and to an inheritance. Now start thinking heaven. It's imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Peter says, this is what we live with. This is the reality of our lives. This is the core reality of our lives. This is the rock we stand on. Verse 6, in this you rejoice. You're going, yeah, this is good news. I'm rejoicing in this. Though now for a little while, nobody knows how long, do they? None of us know. But for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials. so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious. He said, this faith that you and I say, Jesus, I'm going to trust you with my life, everything I have, my children, my grandchildren, my friends, my loved ones, I'm trusting you with this. He said, that is more valuable than gold. You know, your 401k cannot shake a stick at that. This faith is what, this is our life. Christ is our life, and this is how we stay united with him through this faith that perishes, gold that perishes, though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. He's talking about you and me. Us? Praise and glory. We're all going to go, praise, glory, honor to you. And he's going to say, hey, welcome home, kids. Good to have you here. I love these next verse. Though you have not seen him. By the way, Peter had. Peter saw him. He even saw the resurrected Lord. But to us, all of us, though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible. Can you imagine people facing the Colosseum and the lions, living their lives with joy? You mean, is it possible that you and I could live our lives with joy in the midst of this COVID storm? That he would bring us out from under that dark cloud, and we could be points of light for our neighbors around us? You know, just to share love in the neighborhood, with our families, with each other. He says, you, we believe in him, though you do not see him now, you believe in him, and you rejoice with joy that is inexpressible, filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Whew. This is not a bad way to live. I can't think of a better one. Over in 1 Peter 5, look what Peter says. I mean, Peter says, I'm not being a Pollyanna here. There's no Pollyanna stuff here. It's real. He knows the battle's real. This life and death thing is real. Look what he says. 8, be sober-minded. You know, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. Yeah, he wants you. He wants me. What did Jesus tell Peter? Peter, Satan has asked to sift your soul, but I have prayed for you. The same Jesus is praying for you and me. Isn't that good? And then he says this, I love this verse 9. Resist him, this devil who's coming at us. Resist him. Here it is. Little faith, Peter. Firm in your faith. Huh? Firm in faith. Knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you've suffered a little while, we don't know what that little while is, but we know he's there with us in the middle of it. Amen? He says, after you've suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself, here it comes, this is the harbor we've been, you know, hoping for, he's going to restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish. There's terra firma. There's the solid rock that you and I stand on. I love this. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. He will hold you fast. Let's stand together. Lift our voices.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter will prevail, he will hold me fast. We'll never keep on hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He will hold me. He will hold me fast, he will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me. are his delight. Christ will hold me fast, precious in his holy sight. He will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last, bought by him at such a cost. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. My life he bled and died. Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life. He will hold me fast. Till our faith is turned to sight. When he comes at last, and he will hold me fast, he will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast, he will hold me fast. Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast.
Lord, Lord, we're amazed. We're amazed at your grace. Your grace and your mercy. I mean, you know everything about us. You know every thought that has passed through our minds. You know every desire of our hearts. You know everything about us, and yet you love us so much that you would give your very life that we might have life in your name. And on this day, we thank you. We thank you and we praise you. We're amazed at your grace. And thank you so much that we were going down for the last time, that you reached out and took us with a grip that will never slip. You'll never let us go. You'll hold. God, we want to hold on back. But thank you. We know that even on the day that we breathe our last, no longer able to hold, that you will hold us. You'll never let us go. We belong to you. That your desire to say yes to this Jesus on this day, just lift your hand to him and say, Jesus, I'm taking a hold of your hand. I'm saying yes to you. Thank you. I feel the grip. I'm holding on. God, thank you. Jesus, Spirit, let your light shine through me to bless my loved ones. Jesus, come soon. We thank you. We love you. We praise you in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Brothers and sisters, loved ones, God's got this. He's got it. You and I can walk in faith.